சத்குருவே சரணம். மோஸ்ட் ரிவியர்ட் அண்ட் ரெஸ்பெக்டட் சுவாமிஜி அண்ட் மை டியர் கலீக்ஸ், இட் இஸ் ஆல்வேஸ் அ பிளஷர் டு டாக் இன் ஸ்ரீ விஷ்ணுமோகன் ஃபவுண்டேஷன் ஃபார் தி மெயின் ரீசன் தட் வென்எவர் ஐ டெலிவர் எ லெக்சர் I feel that I am blessed by Sri Sadguru. Sri Sadguru's blessings is something which is very much essential for me to carry out my day-to-day activities. So whenever I visit Sri Vishnumohan Foundation, I feel that Sadguru's blessings is always there to guide me and to help me in all my endeavors. And it is always a great inspiration to sit at the feet of Swami Sri Hariprasad Ji and listen to him on various philosophical themes which he would explain to us in great detail. So today I would like to discuss with you the notion of or the concept of conflict resolution in the context of Buddhist philosophical discourse. I would like to start my discussion with a quotation from Swami Sri Hariprasad, that is in Indian Philosophical Congress, the 93rd session, which was held in Nalanda in the year 2009, he was the general president. The IPC was proud and privileged to nominate him as the general president. And he gave a very beautiful lecture. And from that lecture, I would like to quote certain passages. He says, Swami Hariprasad Ji says, peace is the very basis of our nature and our existence. We are peaceful with breaks of non-peaceful activities or thoughts. These happen when we are afflicted with feelings of raga or desire, dvesha or strong dislike, or bhaya of fever. Further, he says, we are peaceful, but sometimes we may feel threatened or sense a desire on another person's part to control us or take something from us, whether it is an office rivalry or a world war. The causes are the same, though the many factors may not be seen and the protagonists may not be even aware of them. So this is a very beautiful quotation by our Swamiji, and this has a lot of message to convey, especially with regard to the conflict resolution. And this year's peace conference theme, which is Swamiji has chosen, is right education as a key for peace. And today, this being the second day of peace conference, we are discussing the notion of conflict resolution. And tomorrow, we shall be discussing sustainable development. So three concepts, I feel, are closely related with the concept of peace. That is education, conflict resolution, and thirdly, sustainable development. Today, I shall be discussing with you on conflict resolution from the Buddhist perspective, as I said earlier. Now, how do we define conflict? The word conflict, in fact, is a Latin word, and it comes from the word conflagrare, which denotes fighting or warfare, incompatibility, and opposition. In fact, it is used both people and groups who have beliefs, attitudes, needs, and benefits that are absolutely different, so that they debate, dispute, and even kill each other as a result. There was one Norwegian peacekeeper, his name is John Galtung. He says that conflict is related to mankind's behavior. This means one can say conflict is closely associated with the human behavior. Conflict arises because people are concerned or understand that there are some groups who are working against their advantage. In fact, Swamiji's discourse, which I quoted, has this point. So hence, conflict, according to the definition, general definition, goes together with attitude and behavior. So the significance of attitude and behavior is very important in the context of conflict resolution. But we must take one point clear here, that is, we are not the same. We are not identical by nature. We differ among ourselves, and our approach to problems differ because we have different attitudes, which means we differ in attitude, in our attitude, and as a result of that, our approach to problem is also different. And human behavior is not one and the same. This means it varies to person to person. Because of the conflict, which actually arises in the mind of the individual, war takes place. War sows the seeds of hatred that generate future war. So if the individual has peace in his mind, and then it would be exhibited in his action. This means, by having peace in our mind, we can avoid wars. This means dialogues and negotiations alone can settle the disputes, and the effect that it produces is always permanent. So this means we have to depend on a dialogue or negotiation, and the result that is produced by both dialogues and negotiation is something permanent. So because of this reason, it can be said that the more of violence, the less of revolution. So all conflicts can be solved by peaceful means and reconciliation. Now, how do we define reconciliation? It is used for both people and group in order to solve the problems, and hence, we must make an effort to transcend the difference. In fact, Sadhguru, in one of our lectures, in one of our discourses, talked about how one can transcend the barriers of the conflict. She says that one can transcend all conflicting opposites, the truth and the falsity, the good and the evil, the real and the unreal. So it is a transformative philosophy which our Sadhguru has preached. And in the transcendental philosophy, she has given us a clue how we can transcend all conflicting opposites. So this means, according to our spiritual guru, who has guided the entire human society without any distinction between caste, creed, and religion, there is a way to solve a problem. And she was all the time concerned about human suffering. And she said that the remedy, which she says, is that inner peace, which is very much essential and which can bring out a change in the individual. Once the individual is changed, then there is a change in the society. And the result of that, there is a change in the country. And as further, there will be change in the entire cosmos. So this means one has to transcend, as Sadhguru says, one has to transcend the conflicting opposites. So ordained by the divine will, she has submitted all her possessions to others. In fact, when the question was asked by one of her disciples, how to get peace, her immediate answer is this: absolute peace comes from absolute renunciation. So renunciation is a guiding principle according to Sadhguru, and which is, she says, is the highest philosophy which can solve most of the problem. And there is always a conflict, not only among human beings, but also a conflict between God and man, or God and human being. In fact, the philosopher Sartre gives a beautiful story which he has narrated. And there is a dialogue between Zeus, the god, and Otius, that is a human being. The dialogue goes like this. God says, Otius, I created you and I created all things. Then the human being says, you are the king of gods, king of stones and stars, king of the waves of the sea, but you are not the king of man. This is very important. Then God says, I am not your king. Who then made you? Then human being says, man says, you, but you are blundered. You should not have made me free. Then God says, I gave you freedom so that you might serve me. Then the man says, I am my freedom. This I am my freedom is very important. No sooner had you created me than I ceased to be yours. This is what J.B. Sartre's dialogue goes with regard to very interesting work, his work on the flies. So this dialogue very clearly shows that the conflict exists not only among human beings, but also between God, who has created the human being, and the human being who has been created by God. So the conflict is inevitable. But we must point out here that there are two ways of understanding the term conflict. In fact, there are two meanings with regard to the notion of a conflict. One has got a positive meaning and the other is a negative meaning. Now, the positive meaning goes like this. That is, conflict is something that leads to creative thinking and the more successful development of organization and society in general. Now, what is the negative meaning of a conflict? Negative meaning is conflict is something that organizations and society cannot manage, and so violence and quarrels will result. So what is the result? Conflict leads to the losing of one's mental balance. Then there is loss of property, failure of reconciliation in society, harmony is disturbed, unity is reduced to singularity. This is a very important point. Unity is reduced to singularity. One is considered always as a threat to other. And Sartre's understanding phrase is to be remembered here, that the other is the hell. Now, there are conflicts which would really help the human society progress. For example, conflict leads to the development of one's own self. And secondly, it helps us to solve many of the political problems. So political development, in the context of political development, conflict is playing a very important role. And conflict, not only that, conflict helps us to revise one's own views. And also conflict is very much essential for economic growth or economic development. Now, there is always a conflict between one and the other. In other words, one can say that there is a conflict between identity and the other. In fact, I would say conflict juxtaposes the identity with the other. It is in opposition of myself with the other. The question is the other meaningful? This is a question quite often raised by the individual. So the concept of intersubjectivity is absent in conflict. And Hegel, for example, philosopher Hegel has pointed out that he has given the example how the master and the servant are closely related. The master needs the service of the servant, and the servant also needs the master. So this means the other is important. In fact, the philosopher Levinas has pointed out the concept of other in a very beautiful manner. He says, we have the responsibility towards the other. So I and you are equal. So open dialogue is the method of solving the conflicting issues. And there is always one can learn from the other. And in fact, it is here the Buddhist philosophy is very much helpful, because Buddhist philosophy respects the other. In fact, it is the philosophy that it preaches in cosmic salvation. When many systems of philosophy are talking about the individual salvation or salvation of one's own self, Buddhist philosophy talks about the salvation of the entire humankind, which is otherwise known as cosmic salvation. So there are different kinds of conflict: community conflict, diplomatic conflict, environmental conflict, then ideological conflict, religious conflict, family. Within family, there is a conflict. There is self-conflict also. And there is also caste conflict. So how to resolve that? The best way is to understand the notion of the other. In fact, our Indian systems, especially the Hindu tradition, the Jaina tradition, the Buddhist tradition, all six traditions, all Indian traditions, religious traditions, talk about how one can overcome this conflict and how this can be resolved. And the Buddhists talk about this in detail. In fact, they say, once we know how to overcome the suffering, the notion of suffering, then many of our problems will be solved. So from the Buddhist perspective, one can say the causes of a conflict are multiple. What are they? Desire, arrogance, and delusion. Most of us are having all the three. So for the Buddhists, conflict is natural and even necessary aspect of human life. So it is neither completely good nor completely bad. So how to live with conflict? Because it is not possible to get away from the conflict at the initial stage. So how to live with conflict is the best possible way. And Buddhism talks about how there is a conflict in different rituals, which is available in Vedic tradition. And Buddha gives a methodology for solving the conflict. In fact, I would say the conflict resolution by Lord Buddha is the need of the hour. Because after enlightenment, he became Buddha and he was equipped to fight the conflict. And he has given the methodology for that. So what is the methodology given by Lord Buddha? To change people from inside and not from outside. And he was trying to change the mind of the people. That's why I said in the beginning itself, our Sadhguru also has pointed out that, first of all, the mind of the individual should be changed, because all conflict arises in mind. So Buddha also said that we have to change the mind of the people. So it does not come from outside, but from within. So if you want to change the system, this is what Lord Buddha says, if you want to change the system, change the mind of the people, clean the mind to avoid conflict. So he said, think about the benefit and the happiness of the people. So conflict, according to Buddha, can be solved by realizing that there is something far more important, also by remembering that we are not always right. If you believe this principle of Lord Buddha, then many of the conflict definitely would vanish. So what Lord Buddha suggests is that there should be what is known as mutual concern, which means we must be ready to accept the other, and the other must also be ready to accept other. And at present, the world is diversity of culture, language, and religion. So conflict between people are inevitable. But Lord Buddha's methodology of this compassionate wisdom is very much essential in this contemporary age in order to solve many of the problems. So Lord Buddha said, when community meet together regularly with with mutual respect, then harmony can flourish. And further, Lord Buddha says, we have to promote cooperation over competition. And here, the significance of Sangha, he has suggested, in order to resolve the conflict. So Buddhist methodology is something which can solve the problem which the entire globe is facing today. And he has preached not only for kings, but for poor people also, but for not only for men, but also to women, Brahmins, outcasts, bankers, and beggars. This means for him, there is no distinction among human beings. And he recognized no difference of caste or social grouping. And man's position, according to Buddhism, is something supreme. He is the human being is his own master, and there is no higher being or power that sits in the judgment over his destiny. This means for Buddha, in fact, I would like to quote Lord Buddha here. He says, one is one's own refuge. Who else could be the refuge? He asks. So it is very much essential to follow the methodology given by Lord Buddha. And further, Lord Buddha says, the root of all evil and conflict is ignorance and the false views. These are the two things which affect human society. According to him, one is ignorance, and the second one is the false views which we are keeping in our mind. So as long as there is doubt, perplexity, wavering, he said, no progress is possible. So once the doubt is clear, once the ignorance is removed, then the conflict, he says, would automatically disappear. So Buddhism says that one should not honor one's own religion and condemn the other religion. This sort of attitude, he says, is not good. So in doing so, this is a very important point. While condemning the other religion, he says that we are injuring our own religion. So he said, I quote Lord Buddha once again, concord is good. Let all listen and be willing to listen to the doctrines professed by others, unquote. So the spirit of tolerance and understanding is one of the key factors in Buddhist culture and civilization. So there is no single example of persecution or the shedding of a drop of blood in converting people to Buddhism. So it spread peacefully all over the continent of Asia. And all of us know the four noble truths, especially the fourth noble truth, the cessation from suffering, is the guiding principle for the entire human society. And in the fourth noble truth is that which gives a way to come out of the cessation of dukkha. So this actually is known as the middle path, for the main reason that it avoids two extremes. What are the two extremes? One extreme being the search for happiness through pleasures of the senses, which is low, common, unprofitable, and the way of the ordinary people. And the other being that the search for happiness through self-mortification in different forms of asceticism, which is painful, unworthy, and unprofitable. So he has taken the middle path in order to guide the entire human society. In fact, he says the middle path gives vision and knowledge, which leads to a calm, insight, enlightenment, which is referred to as a eightfold path. I'm not giving the details regarding that. And in short, one can say if these eight paths are followed, one can avoid conflict. If the conflict arises, it is resolved through the eightfold path of Buddhism. Now, Buddhism actually talks about two kinds of illness, because just now we said that it is not physical, it is mental. So he talks about two kinds of illness. One is the physical illness and the other is the mental illness. So Buddhist way of meditation aims at producing a state of perfect mental health, equilibrium, and tranquility. So in this context, that is, in order to solve the problem of conflict, he speaks about the bhavana. So what is a bhavana? It is a mental culture which aims at cleaning the mind of impurities and disturbances such as lustful desires, hatred, ill will. So this is very much essential. And further, Lord Buddha says two kinds of meditation is very much essential here. One is the development of mental concentration, that is one-pointedness of mind. And the other is also very important, which is otherwise known as vipassana. So it is insight into the nature of things, leading to the complete liberation of mind to the realization of truth, nirvana. This is the Buddhist meditation and Buddhist mental culture. And I got two more points with that I'll conclude. Conflict, according to Buddha, arises because of the following problems. One is the problem between the parents and the children. Parents are scared to their children, which means parents always are afraid of their children, because what they are doing now in this computer age, the parents are very much worried about the children, because they have to watch them at each and every stage, whether they are misusing the computer and all these problems are so. There is always a conflict, and children are always fond of using, computer. So there is a conflict. And there is always a conflict between teacher and people. This we have seen in all educational institutions, because the people may not, students may not be interested, interested in the particular view which is held by the teacher. So there is a conflict. And of course, there is a conflict between husband and wife, which is inevitable, but it's very beautiful because it helps to know each other in a better way. And there is also a conflict between a friend and a friend, and master and servant. And Buddhist way of life avoids all these conflicts, though they point out these are some of the areas where conflict plays a very important role. And Buddhist solution is that we can easily solve all these problems. So Buddhist methodology is something which is very much helpful in resolving many of the conflicts. In fact, in this context, I must say that the Buddhist philosophy does not talk about the rejection of mind or matter. In fact, this is one of the basic problems, because in philosophical discourse, normally people either accept mind or spirit, spirit or mind or matter. And in fact, this kind of subscribing to one concept has created a conflict among philosophers, but Buddhism tries to avoid that. It says mind is not spirit as opposed to matter. Buddha does not recognize a spirit opposed to matter, and mind, according to Lord Buddha, is only a faculty or organ, that is indriya, like eye or ear. So Dhammapada talks about the nature of mind, because all the time I'm talking about the concept of mind in Buddhism, so that, as suggested by our Sadhguru and by Lord Buddha, that if we reform our mind, if we change our mind, if we put our mind in the proper perspective, then other external problems can easily be solved. So that's why Dhammapada gives a beautiful understanding of the nature of mind. It says, mind is a forerunner of states. Mind is chief. If one speaks or acts with a wicked mind, because of that, suffering follows one, even as the wheel follows the hoof of the drought ox. Mind is a forerunner of all good states also. Mind is chief. If one speaks or acts with pure mind, because of that, happiness will follow. The flickering, the fickle mind, difficult to guard, difficult to control, the wise person straightens it as a fletcher straightens an arrow. Like a fish, this is an example given by Lord Buddha, like a fish that is drawn into the watery abode and thrown upon land, even so does this mind flutter. Hence, should the realm of the passions be shunned. So Buddhism, I feel, gives a hope for the future in order to solve all conflicts. So the reconciliation which has been suggested by Buddhism is very much essential. In fact, I would say that Buddhism is a discourse, a philosophical discourse, a religious discourse, which has to be practiced. In fact, I have written a paper wherein I argued that how Buddhism gives a solution to some of the problems that are connected to COVID. And I always feel that Buddhism gives a hope for the future. Buddha talks about his oneness with all living beings. So if this is known, if this is understood in a proper perspective, then there will not be any conflict. There is a promise of hope of life. And the philosophy it preaches is the inward harmony. It is not outward harmony, please note it. It is the inward harmony and has no place for discord. So the text Dhammapada says that he whose delight is inward, who is tranquil and happy when alone, him they call a true bhikshu. For such a person, there is no despair and no mourning. And here I would like to show a beautiful analogy. A beautiful analogy can be drawn in Buddhist way of life. Buddhism says that there are two things that can separate us from father and mother, from brother and sister, and from all those who are most cherished by us. These two are, one, distance, and two, death. In fact, at the time of COVID, Buddhism gives how one can distance himself or herself from the society. This is what we call social distancing. And we should know that Buddhism is not a mere religion. It is a philosophy. It is a way of life. And it is a hope for the future. With this, I conclude my brief speech. And I am grateful to our revered Swamiji, who has been helping me by his guidance. And he's a great supporter of me. And he guides me in all my activities. And I always seek his blessings and the Sadhguru's blessing. Sadhguruve Saranam.